Short Squeeze by Chris Knopf. Narrated by Deanna Hurst.
None of my favorite female friends were spared in the making of this book. You know who you are. The cure for boredom is curiosity. There is no cure for curiosity. Dorothy Parker. Chapter 1. I don't know how to dress. It's easier to just say, "Oh, you're right. This skirt and blouse have no business being together on the same body." That's what I get for dressing in the dark. I feel that way about my life in general. I know it doesn't look very good, but I seem to be missing the specific talent to do anything about it. Getting through law school was probably the only thing I ever did on purpose that might have been a good idea. Even a lousy lawyer can usually make enough money to stay a little north of the poverty line, and I'm not a lousy lawyer. I'm unconventional. A little spotty at times on the finer points, but I usually do okay for my clients. Nobody's asked for their money back. Not yet, anyway. Maybe I'm just a product of my environment. I lived in the Hamptons my whole life, minus the time spent in college and law school. That period away taught me that standard notions of reality aren't always applicable to the east end of Long Island. The outside world thinks living here requires a Bentley, a facelift, and a shingle-style home the size of Buckingham Palace. The truth is a lot more complicated than that. You see a lot of swells in capped teeth and riding boots, but also dusty valiants and tool belts and long-legged, high-heeled sales clerks, like you'd see anywhere. But dig a little deeper, and you're as likely to find a saint or a Mensa genius as you are a deviant or certified nut job lurking right below the surface. I know this because these are my beloved clients. I used to have a home office, but I'd made the house such an unlivable pile of crap that I moved into a room over a row of shops along Montauk Highway, the traffic-clogged two-laner that strings together the Hamptons. The town I'm in is called Watermill. I like the place because there's a coffee shop and a Japanese restaurant within a few seconds' walk, and I can look out the window at a giant windmill whenever I don't want to look at the brief I'm writing, which is most of the time. I can also see the gates to this glorious old estate right at the head of Meacock's Bay that's been a nun's retreat for as long as I can remember. The word is they're going to sell it off to a private group of jillionaires, which explains how such an incredibly valuable piece of property could still be undeveloped. They just hadn't gotten around to it yet. Being Irish Catholic, I can't help wondering if the nuns threw in a few indulgences as part of the deal. I think that kind of thing as quietly as I can, so my dead old man doesn't hear me and try to reach out from the beyond and whack me on the head. Disappointing my old man was a reflex of mine. It almost killed him when I gave up a solid Irish name like O'Dwyer for Swaitkowski when I married that adorable dope Potato Pete. That's what we called him in high school because his family owned the biggest potato farm on the East End, which, like the nun's place across the street, got the attention of real estate developers and soon after got converted into a tidy fortune, a chunk of which my husband used to buy the Porsche Carrera he flew like a jet fighter into a big old oak tree. I sort of almost loved Potato Pete, so I kept Swaitkowski after he died as a kind of memorial. I also think it makes sense for me to have a name nobody knows how to spell or pronounce, and gives me license to kick the shins of any chowderhead who thinks Pollock jokes are funny. Like everyone else, Sergei Ponticello had trouble with the name when he introduced himself to me one day in early fall at my office in Watermill. He'd made it through the door, which was an accomplishment of sorts, given all the junk that somehow got piled up everywhere. I could see him wondering where he was supposed to sit. "Just call me Jackie," I said to him, shoveling a stack of paper off one of the chairs I'd promised myself I'd keep clear for visiting clients.
"People have trouble with Ponticello, too," he said, trying to get comfortable in the old leather chair. "It's the C. You'd think they'd know better. Anyone ever play a cello?
He asked. You drink coffee? I asked him. Tea, orange juice, martini? Just kidding. He smiled weakly.
The martini sounds very good, but I should wait until at least 4 o'clock.
Sergei wasn't a very big guy. Thin, with a long nose and a missing chin that would encourage a cartoonist to turn.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.